Sediments, even in the deep oceans, can be moved by important currents, and they can generate some pretty spectacular depositional architectures. We're going to have a look at some of these in this short presentation. We're going to focus on a small part of the Northwest Atlantic. So where are we talking about? Well, we're here to the west and northwest of the British Isles, and you can see that the seabed has quite a complicated form of basin areas and ridges. Here are their names. So there's the main Rockall Basin, and then there's the Rockall Plateau. Moving out to the northwest, there's the Hatton Basin, and that's separated from the seafloor of the main part of the Atlantic over there in the top left-hand corner by the Hatton Bank. And we're just going to be looking chiefly at one seismic line that runs across the Hatton Basin from the Rockall Plateau to the Hatton Bank. This line here, and here it is. So there on the right-hand side on the east is the Rockall Bank, part of the Rockall Plateau, and over on the left is the Hatton Bank, and in the middle the Hatton Basin, which is divided on this profile by that rather strange structure in the middle, and more of that in a minute. But before looking at the shallow section, the sediments, we should just explain some of the seismic profile, which has a whole series of multiples in it here that we can trace across the profile that simply reflect reverberations between the sea bottom and the shallow geology and the sea surface. So we can see the same multiples come around here in the middle of the Hatton Basin and appear on the Hatton Bank. Well, let's not get confused by these. These are just these artifacts in the seismic record, so we can mix those away. And the geology we're concerned with is the shallow part of the section. Running across the profile here is a big booming reflector which represents the top of the acoustic basement. And this basement are volcanics of tertiary age and their younger strata that overlie them. And these are the things that we're interested in. So we can see that the Hatton Basin is divided here by a volcanic edifice, and there are two main accumulations of sediment. But it's interesting, these don't just simply onlap the substrate. The seabed contains some slightly strange features in here, which are sort of moat structures there. Low-lying parts that separate the main sediment body from their underlying rocks. So maybe these are sites where submarine currents have been particularly strong, and they've scoured away the sediment at the break and slope. So to explore that notion, let's zoom in now to the moat on the right-hand side, or the eastern side of the Hatton Basin. Here it is. And we can see, coming down from the right, the acoustic basement, the volcanics, there's a veneer of slightly younger sediment on top, inclined down to the left. And then we can see the sediments of the Hatton Basin and that little moat structure in the middle of the screen. Well, let's zoom in on that. There we go. Scale there, 5 kilometres that we're looking across. We're quite zoomed in here, and we can see that moat, which in reality is a few tens of metres deep. Let's pick some reflectors within the sediments. And they onlap the top of an older package of sediments, and the onlap surface there is picked in green. Well, you can see the moat structure on the seabed, but as you go down in the subsurface, you can see other features that have got more complicated forms. And the sediments of the Hatton Basin have not accumulated perfectly horizontally, but show various mounded shapes. But if we look at the modern seabed and we can see that the immediate underlying reflectors more or less follow it, this implies that the moat structure is not erosional, it's simply differential sediment aggradation. There's less sediment accumulated in the moat than there is adjacent to it, but everything is still accumulating up the system. It's not an erosive feature. So sediment is being reworked and moved around differentially on the floor of the Hatton Basin. And we're over 1 kilometre below sea level here. Well, so much for the Hatton Basin. Now let's move up onto the Rockall Bank. We're still well below the depth at which wave action may be going on. But there's still some pretty complicated sediment architectures in here. Let's go and have a look. So here's a zoom in on part of the regional profile. And again, let's just deal with the multiple in here, and we'll mix that away and be concerned with the real geology that lies in the shallow part of the profile. And again, we can pick the top of the basement of the volcanics coming around here, and we're concerned with the sediments that lie above this volcanic surface. Let's zoom into this area here. Some pretty spectacular geometries. And zoom in again. So again, we can see the seabed that's got quite a lot of relief on it. That trough in the middle there is probably about 60 to 100 meters deep. Let's pick a surface through here, which is an erosional feature. We look at the V in the middle here, which lies underneath the trough structure on the seabed. You can see that the either side of this, that the stratal reflectors are truncated. So that low-lying part of the modern seabed is a residual feature, as the incised V-shaped valley in there has been filled in progressively by those sediments that lie above the blue pick. So the modern seabed is less irregular than it used to be, and the modern sediments are gradually filling and healing that eroded surface picked out in blue. Well, let's look a little bit below that blue there now, and we can see that the deeper parts of the shallow section contain some really complicated mounded sediment packages in here. There's some over here, and an interesting feature of these is that these particular mounds appear to be amplifying as they've built up, so that the waviness increases as they move to younger parts of their pile. If we look at the mounds just to the right of those, the opposite seems to occur, so that the initial mounds are relatively well developed and they lose definition as they go up. And there's a final one here just on the other side of the V-trough, which looks like it might have migrated leftwards as it's aggraded out. Sediment mounds, clearly then sediments being moved and differentially deposited across this part of the seabed during this period. Let's step out again. And we're going to move to the flanks of the Hatton Basin as we move off the gentle ground of the rock or bank. Let's zoom into this area here. So again, we can pick the top of the volcanics, and this is overlain by patches of sediment which are reasonably discontinuous as we go down the flanks of the Hatton Basin. Let's look at this one in here. Look at the scale. That's the profile there's about 10 kilometers across, and it's 250 milliseconds that we're looking at in there, which represents a differential bathymetry of about 200 meters. So really big vertical exaggeration. But we can use this to look at the internal architectures. Look at those crazy bed forms that lie within that sediment patch. So there's scouring going on the left-hand side of that profile, but there's also really complicated stratal geometries as the sediments have piled up and be moved and shifted by submarine currents. Finally, let's look at a different seismic profile now that was acquired by the seismic company Fugro on the other side of the Rockall Plateau, moving onto the flanks of the Rockall Basin. Well, here's that profile. We can see the Rockall Plateau over there on the top left-hand side of the profile and the seabed dropping away to the right into the Rockall Basin. And we're just going to look at part of that flank in there. Some really spectacular sedimentary geometries. We can see that high frequency patch of seismic record sediment there that lies on the seabed. It's worth pointing out the scale. It's 15 kilometers across by 1.5 seconds two-way time vertically. That sediment patch, if we put it to a more realistic form, that's what it really looks like with no vertical exaggeration. It's a classic example of a sediment form called a contrarite. Indeed, all these features we've been looking at are contrarites. Sediments moved around on the seabed, making these deposits as a consequence of deep marine currents. And in this particular case, the sediment body has migrated upslope, and we can see evidence for that by the internal architecture of the sediment body, with all those inclined surfaces getting progressively younger from right to left, implying upslope migration of this particular bed form. So a quick look at contrarite drifts, these sediment bodies that are moved around and accumulated by currents operating in the deep ocean basins. They can make some pretty spectacular stratal geometries and mega bed forms as we've just seen. Understanding their form and mapping them out can reveal how ocean basin currents have evolved through time.